SE Linux Policy Administration. Let's discuss the basics. It's a good thing to know how to make the case for SE Linux for yourself, so that you know how you can employ, how you can use SE Linux, but also to be able to explain to others why one would need or one would use SE Linux, and what the benefits of SE Linux are as opposed to other security systems. So the mandatory start for me is to basically mention a paper that was published by the National Security Agency in the previous decade, with title "The Inevitability of Failure: The Flawed Assumption of Security in Modern Computer Environments." Basically, this paper was published right about the same time as when the SE Linux security framework was introduced for inclusion in the Linux kernel. And it basically makes the case for secure operating systems, the need for secure operating systems. Basically, explains that we're assuming that security in traditional computer environments is suffice. And it explains why that is not the case, what it's lacking, and things like that. But the main two points to take away from this paper is, and you can basically also look up this paper, you can, I can't actually select it, but basically you could type this into your browser and use your favorite search engine to look up the PDF. And you might want to read it, or actually store a copy of it on your hard drive, because it's it's basically an important paper, and it has a good explanation of the issues. But anyways, the two points that the paper makes, in my view, the points that I take away from it is that we always need to keep in mind that man is flawed. Woman is flawed, man is flawed. I should probably change that to human is flawed. Basically, people always make mistakes. No matter how good you are at something, a mistake is easy to make, and that's just a fact of life. But we should, when it comes to security, accept that it happens and deal with it. We should basically recognize that this is an issue, that we can't trust human beings, not because they are necessarily malicious, but just because it's easy to make mistakes. And so we need to deal with that. So then the next point basically automatically is a way to deal with that issue. So because man is flawed, so we're basically talking about processes on the computer system, or actually processes on the computer system, basically active entities, whether it's you connecting to the computer through a login shell, or logging in with a login shell, or you're running a user agent, an application on the system. They're both processes on the system, and they're both basically human. The application that you might run on the computer system is written by a human being, and you're logging in a with a login shell is also, are you the human being basically logging into the system? So when it comes to processes, we're basically talking about humans one way or in one way or another. So we need a secure operating system to deal with the fact that man is flawed. We need to basically be able to constrain or to contain humans on the operating system level. And that's something that currently, or at that point when that paper was published, was basically not the norm. It was basically not usual. So basically that's what the paper explains. It basically says, okay, this is the problem. This is what we currently have. It's just not suffice. We need to, and how to deal with that? We need to make sure that we have a secure operating system so that we can basically deal with these issues. So the next slide goes a little bit further into this. So SE Linux is what's called a flexible mandatory access control that complements identity-based discretionary access control. And you could probably make it even more, make the description even more fine-grained. Flexible, configurable, host identity-based, host-based mandatory access control that complements identity-based access identity-based discretionary access control. So to understand this, let's just first have a little talk about identity-based access identity-based discretionary access control. So in a usual system, in a traditional system, not a usual system, in a traditional Linux security Linux environment, there's basically this default security framework that is discretionary access control framework that's based on identities. So when you log into a system, you have this identity, which you can see here on at my prompt in the shell. My identity is Dominic, and Dominic is associated to a user ID in the form of, in the shape of a number. And I, the administrator created this user identity. So it's, this is basically an identifier that is associated to a number, which is also an identifier. But the point I'm trying to make clear here is that the identifier, the identity, is created by us. The discretionary access control framework allows us to create identifiers. So the security is based on the identifier. So let's have a look at that. So let's say I make a file, touch file, and just ls all file. So let's have a look at this. So the security attributes of a traditional Linux security in a traditional Linux security system, a discretionary access control. So the file is has a name, it's called file. And then identities are assigned to that file, which are user identity and group identity. So the user identity is Dominic, and the group identity is Dominic in this case. And then basically there are permission bits assigned as well, which govern how users, groups, and others can operate on this file. So the first bit here tells us what kind of object we're dealing with. The dash basically tells us it's a single file, and that's what it is because we did touch file, so it's a single file. But if I would, for example, create a link, a soft link or a sim link, then there would be an L here. If I would create a character file, there would be a C here. Or if I would create a block file, it would be a be here, or if I would create a sock file, it would be an S, and if I would create a FIFO file or a pipe, it would be a P, I think it is, for pipe. But anyways, the first bit basically just tells us what kind of object we're dealing with, and in this case a file. And then the second three bits basically govern how the owner of the file, Dominic, can interact with the can operate on the file. And the second three bits do the same, but then for the group, which is also Dominic in this case, and the last three bits do the same, but then for others on the system. Now, the owner of the file, the creator of the file, basically has discretion over how to set these bits. So basically the owner of the file governs the security aspects of this file. So if you have, for example, 1,000 users, then you have basically 1,000 security administrators in a sense, because they all, its user identity governs the security aspects of the files that they create. So that's one property of traditional Linux security. And the same goes for processes. Identities are assigned to processes. And, well, processes can are basically associated to the security attributes of processes are associated to the security attributes of files. So my process, my identity is Dominic here, and that means that, and this file is owned by Dominic, so that associates to each other. The user ID is Dominic, and here you see the numerical value of the identifier. And it associates, so the UID is the same as the UID here, so I'll be able to create it. So let's just make an example of that. Gmod 777, I guess, and a file, and then ls. Oops, ls file. Ls all file. Sorry. And now basically everybody has access to this file. No matter who you are, if you have access to the system, then you automatically have a user identity on the system, and every user identity on the system, identity on the system, has access to this file, provided that you have access to the location where this file is stored. But the point is that you as a user, as a creator of a file, govern security over that file. So that's identity-based discretionary access control in a nutshell. Now, flexible mandatory access control complements identity-based access control. So that's an important point. That's why I underlined it. It complements. It's not designed to replace it. It's an add-on. It's a layer that basically is located below the traditional Linux security layer, so below the identity-based discretionary access control layer. So that means that when some access is requested, first the discretionary access control security attributes are checked. So if Joe, for example, tries to access this file, then the traditional Linux security system checks whether the bits would allow the identity of Joe to either read, write, or execute this file. And after that, it will check the SE Linux or the mandatory access control security attributes to see if that's allowed. And if both are, or actually if it's not if both, but for example, if the traditional Linux security says, okay, this user is, Joe is not allowed to read it, and Joe attempts to read it, then it's game over, because the traditional Linux security system is on top of the stack. So there's no need to check the security system below in the stack, because the first already says no, traditional Linux security says already no, so it's already game over. But if, for example, the traditional Linux security system says, okay, yeah, Joe can read it, then the second security system in the stack kicks in and is also basically asked whether Joe should be able to read the file. And so if traditional Linux security says, okay, Joe can read it, but as Linux says, no, Joe cannot read it, then it's still game over. So that's basically an important concept to understand, that when SE Linux is able to override traditional Linux security and when not. So sits below traditional Linux security and complements traditional Linux security. So some of the issues with traditional Linux security. First of all, it's just not comprehensive. We have some security needs that it just doesn't deal with, and there's some things that it does deal with are just basically not of this time, so to speak. So let's just first explain some of the issues that basically, where SE Linux basically tries to enforce additional security. So that's with regard to enforcing integrity. So in integrity, if you look at integrity from a traditional Linux security perspective, then basically it's pretty much limited to the identity and the bits. So basically, if you have two users on the system and both have different identities, obviously, then that could be an integrity in the sense that one identity cannot access the system resources of another identity if the permission bits are configured properly. But the processes that are owned by the same identity are basically all running with the same security attributes, and so there's no integrity there. But let's first discuss the decentralized property of traditional security, and I already touched on that, where basically each user, each identity has discretion over how to govern the security of files or processes and system resources that it owns. So if you have 1,000 users, then you have 1,000 security administrators in a sense. Now, the problem here is that, for example, if you are operating in a shared computer system, and for example, you're operating on that computer system on behalf of a company, and you are basically tasked to write some confidential sensitive report or something like that on behalf of your company, then basically you probably create a file in one way or another and just put that sensitive data inside that file. However, then because you created that file, you basically are also responsible for the security of that file, because your identity is assigned or associated to the file, and so you can set the bits. So basically, the company itself, the executives, I guess, are basically entrusting you with the security of the security aspect of the data as well. And that's something you might not want as a basically as a leader. You probably want to be responsible for the security, or you want someone else to be responsible for the security of the file. The creator of the file is probably is likely to be should be only responsible for the data that's going inside that file, for basically doing the work, and someone else should be responsible probably for the security of the file. So you don't want a user creating that file and then just inadvertently setting the permission bits for others to read, write, and execute, and then basically others on the system would be able to modify the file or read it or actually send it out or something like that. So you don't want to necessarily trust the person that creates a file to actually govern the security of that file. So that's basically the decentralized or discretionary aspect of traditional Linux security, that where if you create the file, then you're automatically enabled to govern security. And that's just something that in reality is just not realistic. So SELinux is a mandatory access control. So unlike traditional decentralized discretionary access control, SELinux is governed centrally. It means that there's one or a few entities on the system that govern the security, unlike traditional Linux security, where basically every identity on the system governs some security. And since SELinux complements traditional Linux security, it's an add-on. So in some sense, there's still the discretionary aspect, because it's still in place. So, but mandatory access control, the decentralized governance of security, is basically sitting below there and is basically able to override that in some cases. In the case where, and I already explained that as well, where, for example, a user allows, an owner of a file allows everyone to read it, but SELinux basically overrides that by saying, no, you might allow it, but I don't allow it. And so access is denied. But on the other hand, if the owner of a file says this, other users are not allowed to read it, then SELinux won't be able to say, but I override it, and because I think others should be able to read it, so I'll allow it. You can allow it, but the access will still be denied because the user, the owner of the file, basically is on top of the stack. And if he says no, then push comes to shove, it's no. Although, of course, in theory, the root identity is able to change the bits anyways, so he could override that, but then it wouldn't be persistent because the user could basically change that back. The owner of the file could basically change that back. Now the point I'm trying to make is complements. I'm trying to explain the stack, where the traditional Linux security is on top of the stack, and SELinux is basically below on that stack, and then the stack is checked, and whoever denies access first, access is denied. And basically, that enables one to deny access on a system-wide, on an operating system level, rather than on a process level, I guess, or on a user level, identity level. So, Dominic can be can allow everyone to read it, but as a security administrator, as a Linux security administrator, I could basically insert some policy that says, but no one can read that file, and then no one can read that file anyways, because that's the decision by the identity is overridden by the security administrator, as a Linux security administrator, on a system-wide level, centralized. So centralized versus decentralized. One central place where security is governed versus various places where various security is governed. And then I'm basically talking about the identities. Each identity on the system in a traditional Linux security system has some discretion over some security. All right, so the second issue where SE Linux tries to basically tries to fix, the second issue that SE Linux basically tries to fix is that the discretionary access control, so the traditional Linux security, is a coarse-grained access control. And that means access permissions. So, and I already touched on that as well. So basically, the only integrity that you have in a traditional Linux security system is basically the user identities and the permission bits. Basically, what you could do is provide some integrity between the user identities. So if I basically create a file as Dominic, then I could, for example, enforce integrity. Dominic could enforce integrity by not allowing other users on the system to read, write, or execute it. But that requires other identities, because if you compare that to, for example, let's say Dominic has a bunch of processes that runs on behalf of Dominic, then all these processes have the same identities. And then, so that you can't govern security for the processes that you own, because, well, they all have the same identity. So they all have access to all the files that you own on that system. So, for example, your browser runs with your identities, all PS, X, and then I guess AUX, and then grab Firefox, I guess. So Firefox runs with your identity here. So Firefox is basically able to govern security over all the files in your home directory, because the files, for example, the file that I created is also owned by Dominic. So Firefox could govern security over my file, because, well, the owners are the same, and that sucks. So because basically now you're entrusting Firefox to not mess with your file, and all the while Firefox has nothing to do with that file. So basically you trust that Firefox doesn't have bugs, or isn't malicious, isn't accessing some malicious site, or some malicious uses some malicious plugin or whatever. So yeah, each process that runs on your behalf, runs with your identity, can basically manage the security of your processes and system resources. And that's just basically a lot of unnecessary risk. So, and it's also access permissions, because, well, Firefox shouldn't be shouldn't need to govern security over your other files, over other stuff that you have that runs on your behalf. So it's just access permissions, and not just from that perspective, but Firefox has access permissions in the first place. Firefox is allowed to do stuff that it doesn't need to do. So it's coarse grained. It's just there is some integrity in there, but it's very, it's discretionary, because well, the user identity can change the security attributes. So a lot of it is discretionary, and on the other hand, it's just very coarse grained, because there's just very little security attributes that you can use to define what a process can do, or what a user identity can do, and what not. And as Linux, on the other hand, is designed to be least privileged. So, and it's designed to be fine grained. So as Linux is a mandatory access control framework that basically provides a lot of attributes, so to speak, that enables you to restrict processes in a fine-grained manner, so that we can basically allow these processes, each individual processes, to do what only what it needs to do. So from a traditional Linux perspective, this process might be have the identity of Dominic, and so would be allowed to govern security of all Dominic's files. But we could, from a mandatory access control perspective, say, yeah, that might be the case, but we don't want this process to be able to change the security attributes of, for example, the file. Or we don't want this process to be able to signal another process. Or we don't want a process to use some capability or some or the network or whatever. So this allows us to basically go further with regard to integrity than just the identity and the permission bits. We can basically specify per process what a process is allowed to do. And we'll talk about the technical details about that later. But so that's basically how you enhance integrity, by basically centralizing it. So they can basically, you make from, for example, 1,000 security administrators, you make one security administrator. And by making access access permissions, turn that into least privilege. So instead of allowing each process very much permissions, you'll allow it only what it needs. And that's what it enables. I'm not saying that you have to do that. I'm not saying that as Linux is a framework, so it allows you to do it. But you can still decide to depend on traditional Linux security in to some extent, or to in the full extent. It's just your call. The flexibility, and that's also why I mentioned the flexible, and I should also mention configurable. But we'll get into that later. But the flexible aspect of Azure Linux is that it enables you to implement fine-grained mandatory access control, centralized access control. But you don't have to, whether it's to some small extent or in the full extent, it just enables you to do so. So if people say, okay, one disadvantage of Azure Linux is that it's fine-grained, you hear that every once in a while, then I would argue, well, that's not a disadvantage, because the security policy that you implement doesn't have to be fine-grained. It allows you to make it fine-grained, but it doesn't have to be fine-grained. That's just up to the person that configures the security system. So fine-grained access control is a plus, not a minus. It's something. It enables you to. It gives you more flexibility. But it's not a hurdle. It's not because you don't have to do it. But some systems want to make take advantage of that fine-grained access control, and therefore specify exactly what a process can do, because they can. Whether that's good or not, that's just depends on the requirements. And that's why also, if you work with SE Linux, you should just know a little bit about security, how to implement security generally in a good way. Because one golden rule with security is that you first make a report or assess the threats on the system, and then just basically target the threats, neutralize the threats. You can't just basically lock everything up, whether it makes sense or not, just because you can, because that will basically hurt usability. And by hurting usability, you also hurt security. So you need to really basically have a plan and work towards a plan when you use SE Linux or any security tools, I guess. So the flexibility is not something that you have to use to the full extent, or the fine-grained access control, but you can, and that's why it's a plus and not a minus. So if people say, okay, yeah, that's just a problem with SE Linux, that it's just so fine-grained, then you can just argue say, okay, yeah, SE Linux framework allows for fine-grained mandatory access control, but you don't have to. You can make it as coarse-grained as you like. You could implement SE Linux and basically have it act as a discretionary access control, basically make it so that it doesn't do anything. It's there, but it doesn't enforce any centralized fine-grained access control. That's possible. So anyways, those are the two points where SE Linux basically enhances traditional integrity. Now there's also some additional things that traditional Linux security doesn't deal with at all, and SE Linux allows you to optionally deal with that. So these are additional optional constraints, and with additional I mean they're on top of the integrity measures, so to speak, and they're optional, so you don't have to use it. And if you use them, then they don't change the default integrity measures, they add on to them. So they can, just like SE Linux can override traditional Linux security, the additional optional constraints can override the default integrity measures. Of course, only from a deny perspective. They can only, if for example, from a integrity perspective, SE Linux denies something, then you can't allow that with the additional optional constraints. But if something from an integrity perspective, SE Linux integrity perspective, allows some access, then you might be able to deny that access anyways with the additional optional constraints. So additional optional, important to understand. And the two things, the main things that SE Linux optionally provides is enforcement of confidentiality. And that's basically, it allows you to control the flow of information in shared computer systems. And this is basically useful. For example, if you have shared computer systems where you have several users connected to the system, b- with different sensitivities. So one user on the system could have a higher sensitivity than another, or yeah, so to speak. And then there's a rule that says no read up and no write down. So there's a hierarchy of sensitivities, a high sensitivity and a low sensitivity, and there can be numerous sensitivities in between those. And then there's a rule that says, okay, no read up and no write down. So the user with the high sensitivity cannot write down to lower sensitivities, and processes with lower sensitivities cannot read up to processes or to read up higher sensitivities. And you as an administrator are allowed to assign associate sensitivities to processes and system resources in a centralized place. And you can use least privilege as opposed to access in a access way. So enforcing confidentiality now, that's, oh, and basically also confidentiality also allows for compartmentalization. So if you enforce confidentiality, then you're automatically also enforcing compartmentalization, which is basically you assign compartments to processes and only allow access to system resources or processes that have the same compartment. So you compartmentalize it by assigning compartments to processes and system resources, and then just govern that processes can only interact with processes with the same compartment or operate on system resources with the same compartment. And that allows you to enforce compartmentalization. So confidentiality and compartmentalization. And that's basically additional, and that's used for, that can be useful in companies. Compartmentalization can be useful in companies, and confidentiality as well, but I doubt that many companies use that. But if it's, for example, Department of Defense, then confidentiality is just a must. And well, you can actually see it in the news where top secret information was leaked by some contractor, and it turns out that compartmentalization was not properly implemented or enforced. That's what I think the latest news explained, that although the contractor had full access to all sensitivities, he didn't have access to all compartments. But since compartmentalization wasn't enforced, he was able to access data in other compartments, from other compartments. So you have this hierarchy of sensitivities, and then you have these compartments, and you combine the two, and then you'll be able to enforce confidentiality, the control of the flow of information, and compartmentalization. But like I said, it's additional, optional. It adds extra constraints over the other constraints that are implemented by default. And you should know how it works, but we'll focus on the defaults as much as possible, because these two additional constraints add complexity. And like I said, if you don't need it, you shouldn't add more complexity than strictly needed. So hopefully that explained the issues with integrity, the issues that traditional Linux security has with enforcing integrity, and the shortcomings, the things that traditional Linux security can't provide at all, confidentiality and compartmentalization, and that SE Linux complements traditional Linux security. It's an add-on. It sits below traditional Linux security, where it basically can override traditional Linux security to deny something but not to allow something. And the same goes for the initial optional constraints as opposed to the default constraints that SE Linux uses. You can override the integrity constraints with the optional constraints by denying it but not by allowing it. And that's basically the big picture, and it's pretty hard to comprehend, but just look at it as a stack with layers. You have the on top of the stack you have the traditional Linux security, below there you have the default SE Linux, and then below there on the stack you have the optional and additional SE Linux, and then basically each phase in the stack can override the layers above, but only to deny and not to allow something that's denied in a layer on top of the stack or above the stack. All right, now questions then, I'll hear that. And then basically the last part of this section is let's discuss the advantages of SE Linux over traditional Linux, traditional mandatory access control systems. So there are other mandatory access control systems. SE Linux isn't the only one that does centralized security. There's others like Trusted Solaris, and there's other systems that do it. But SE Linux has advantages compared to the other mandatory access control systems. So we'll just discuss them here so that you can basically explain why you would want to use SE Linux over, for example, Trusted Solaris or whatever other mandatory access control system. So SE Linux is a flexible security framework, and that basically means that two things basically. SE Linux allows a lot of, or provides a lot of access factors. And access factors are basically ways to access things. So there's plenty different ways to access something. And that's called an access factor, and it's an important thing. And I'm not sure if I can actually do it, but there's this command. I will get into those details later. But here you have access, a list with access factors, and we can basically list through them. So an access factor, and we'll get into the details later, but an access factor is basically made up of two things: a object class and a set of access vector permissions. Now there's like 83 object classes, so 83 classes of system resources, and we can basically list them. These are the ones. So there's just many different classes of system resources. So for example, a block file has a separate object class. A dir file object is a different object class. And those are the obvious ones. Nodes, for example, nodes on the network. It's a different object class files. And then you can actually have it's shared semaphores, if you know what those are, different object class. There's a security object class, so there's plenty of different objects on the system, and each have a own classification. And each of these classes have ways that you can operate or interact with that class. So, and that's what I showed you here with the XC. So for example, if you look at a file, let's look at the file, which is the most obvious. Where is file? Here it is, file. So a file, how can you basically access a file in theory? You could basically append a file, create a file, execute a file, write a file, relabel from a file, link a file or unlink a file, IO control, get the attributes of a file, set the attributes of a file, read the file, rename the file, lock the file, relabel to, mount on a file, quota on a file, swap on a file, audit access, entry point. So there's plenty ways you can interact or operate, sorry, that you can operate on a file. And these are provided by Azure Linux, these access vectors. So this basically is an access vector. And these are provided by Azure Linux. So there are many as opposed to very little. It's very fine grained. So that's basically why Azure Linux is so flexible, because it provides so many access vectors. And on top of that, Azure Linux is very configurable. So we talked about identities as opposed with in relation to traditional Linux security, where you create a user identity, and then that user identity is associated to processes and system resources owned by that identity. Now, Azure Linux allows you to create identifiers and associate those identifiers to processes and system resources. And whereas traditional Linux security basically only allows you to create and assign or create user identity identifiers and group identity identifiers, the system basically associates that to files and to processing system resources, because automatically, because if you create a file, then your identity is are associated to that file. And the same with a process, if you execute a file, then the process that spawns from that file has your identities automatically. Azure Linux basically provides more configurability, flexibility, because it allows you to basically create security identifiers, but also assign those security identifiers. So if you put those two together, then you'll have a very much flexibility and configurability, because they the two aspects basically correlate to each other. So you have if you look at security, you always have two parties. You have at least one active entity that does something to either another active entity or a something or to a passive entity. So there's always two parties in an interaction, and then you have at least two security identifiers: the security identifier of the source active entity and the security identifier of the target active entity. And then you have the access vectors provided by Azure Linux on top of there. And then you can make decisions based on all these attributes, so to speak. So there's a lot of flexibility there. But that's just if you look at it from one security identifier. But Azure Linux allows you to create various different security identifiers. And I will get into that later, but that basically is allows for more combinations, and that makes it very, very flexible. At least it allows you to make it very, it gives you the flexibility, but it doesn't mean that you need to use all those all those attributes in a fine-grained manner. It allows you to do it. And that's what makes it flexible. I will get into that later. But that's basically, I guess this is it for part one, for the first section. And yeah, it's plenty to digest, and also it's just basically a main overview. I don't expect you to now understand exactly how everything works, but it's just some mandatory, some basics that you just need to get out of the way before you can understand the others. So I'm trying to get to enable a natural flow. But yeah, that's just hard to do, because at some point you need to introduce some concepts or introduce some terminology, and you can't actually cover the details fully yet. So just try to understand as much as possible, and then later on look back and try to fit in the pieces when we're done with later chapters. So yeah, this ends part one, because the next slide goes into different matter.